Wow, wait till you see on that screen what I see on this one. You are in for a huge treat, and I am delighted to welcome all of you here this evening. I hope by now that you've had a chance to see our 25th anniversary exhibition, Transfigurations, Modern Masters from the Wexner Family Collection. I dare say if you haven't yet ventured into the galleries after tonight's presentation, we won't be able to hold you back. We are absolutely thrilled to have been able for the next 3 months to share this extraordinary collection with its exquisite and very finely honed concentration of work by Picasso, by Giacometti, and by Dubuffet, along with a handful of others. And while all of those names are familiar to everyone, and in fact, sort of etched permanently in the pantheon of 20th century culture, I think it's fair to say that this exhibition is by no means meant as some kind of trophy display of gorgeous treasures, although they are in fact luminous works. But in fact, when Les and Abigail very graciously agreed to the notion of publicly presenting their collection, my colleagues and I here, along with our guest curator, Rob Storr, committed that we would bring supreme curatorial and art historical rigor to these works. We would build a rich educational component around the show. We would focus on how to best reach not only the 50,000 university students here at Ohio State, but throughout the state of Ohio and the region, K through 12 kids, and of course the general public. And at the same time, of course, we wanted to bring to Columbus those luminaries in the field of art history, and particularly 20th century art history, those people who have so distinguished themselves in the field over the years, that to have the opportunity to hear their views on some works that you might think you know well, but believe me, you ain't heard nothing yet. We are absolutely thrilled that in order to kind of do justice to the rigor and the discernment that the Wexners have devoted to building this collection, we have in turn tried to replicate in terms of the constellation of people that we are bringing here to discuss the exhibition. And of course, first among equals on that list for me was TJ Clark. Those of you who may have been with us 10 years ago when we inaugurated the Lambert Family Lectures probably recall a riveting lecture on a single painting by de Kooning. And it was exemplary of the way that Tim has taught art history to now a couple of generations of acolytes, some of whom are in this audience tonight. I was really surprised to learn how many of his former students at Berkeley, from Harvard, and from UCLA, where I had the good fortune to study with him, have actually alighted in Columbus. It was really quite a pleasure. All of you can read in your program Tim's bona fides and credentials, but what I wanted to just comment on briefly, because those honors and those degrees can't ever quite give you a sense of what an extraordinary thinker and teacher he is. As I mentioned in his all-too-brief tenure at UCLA, I counted myself among the fortunate students who sat there rapt through lectures that seemed to be one giant sentence. I don't think Tim ever takes a breath, but every utterance was quite brilliant. And I think many in the audience tonight would share my feeling that he, in fact, is the kind of teacher that changes people's lives. And it is such a pleasure to bring him back to the Wexner Center now For the third time, he was here again 5 years ago when the Wexner Center organized with San Francisco MoMA the exhibition of Luke Toymans, a fascinating, perplexing, very difficult, ultimately brilliant painter. And I think he met his match in conversation that night with T.J. Clark. I can't tell you what it means to me personally to be able to welcome him a third time to the Wexner Center, to the Ohio State University. I can tell you this, he has a way of looking at paintings, really seeing paintings in such a kind of fresh lens, that whether it's Manet or it's de Kooning or it's Luke Toymans, or as you'll see, it's not one but two Picasso paintings, you will never quite look at those works of art in the same way again. And I just can't wait to hear his ever sage, savvy, and seductive musings on Marie-Thérèse Walter as Picasso depicted her not once but twice in the year 1932. So with utmost appreciation and respect to our extraordinary patrons, Les and Abigail Wexner, and for his always generous and gracious erudition, I ask you to join me in a warm welcome for T.J. Clark.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you so much, all of you, for coming, and thank you to Sherry for that wonderful introduction. She's a very old friend, a very dear friend, and I thank her for the invitation to launch this series, which she did with her, you know, unfailing enthusiasm and persuasiveness, and it's great to be here. I want to thank her and also to thank Amanda Potter for, you know, her extraordinary care. It's a very special occasion, actually, to be talking about the great Wexner picture with it just so nearby. And just only a few days ago, I was in the room at Tate Modern in London, where the other picture is on long-term loan. So, you know, this is sort of Picasso live, really, in a very special way. So, some of you will know that the book on Picasso I published last year begins by discussing the two extraordinary large-scale nudes he painted in 1932. Here they are. The one in the Wexner's collection at present on show here, and the one belonging to a Russian oligarch who's lent it to Tate Modern in London. I want to return to the paintings tonight, and in particular say more than I dared to in the book about the painting now in London. At the time I was writing Picasso and Truth, it was still in a very private collection in Los Angeles and hadn't been on public exhibition for two or more decades. I'll try first of all to suggest why my book began with the two nudes, and this will involve me explaining a little about the book's overall intentions and how the two paintings fit. But there has to be a preface even to that introduction. I don't think that writers about art choose, or ought to choose, the paintings they write about because they fit or exemplify an argument. In large measure, I chose to begin Picasso and Truth with the two nudes because I couldn't escape from them, because they haunted me, because they stood for something in Picasso's art that I found dreadful and irresistible. Dreadful and irresistible. I do mean both. This talk will have failed utterly if it ends up having one term completely eclipse the other. I mean, I suppose in the end it drifts towards irresistible, but I think the dreadfulness ought to still be there and keep us on our toes. Maybe I could put the problem another way and say this. I admire the two nudes immensely, but that doesn't mean I approve of them. And even the word admire is too weak. I'm continually astonished and disbelieving in front of the paintings from 1932. They seem to me more powerful and splendid than any human being should have been capable of, least of all in the dreadful circumstances of 1932 in Europe. But I still recoil from them. One side of me wants to resist their picture of the world and the human. This leads to my overall first proposition. Approval in the matter of art isn't the name of the game. Otherwise, what would I, as a 21st century atheistic socialist, be expected to make of, say, this wonderful glorification of a slave-holding, phallocentric young Greek aristocrat? Or of this hymn of praise to the power of painting in the service of absolutism? In a word, I don't think we should ever stop remembering the famous dictum of Walter Benjamin. There is no document of civilization that is not at the same time a document of barbarism. But let's also attend to what Benjamin actually said here. Not that what pretends to be a picture of civilization is really always just barbarism and cruelty in disguise, but that civilization and barbarism are the two equally real faces of the same coin. Or to adapt the term to the kind of art we're looking at, that the two nudes of 1932 are simultaneously humane and oppressive, tender and monstrous, pictures of the possibility of pleasure and mutuality, and pictures perhaps of entrapment and submission. In this, by the way, they're typical of Picasso's art as a whole. The question that follows then, and it continues to tear apart the Picasso literature, is this. Should we regard this two-sidedness as a, let's say, monstrosity and tenderness and beauty? Right? Those two things always pulling against each other in Picasso's art. Should we regard this two-sidedness as a form of realism, alas, in the face of the dangerous thing called sex? Or is it ultimately a dark celebration of dominance and submission? And do we approve of artists in the tragic 20th century who show us a world in which sexual and social equality and mutuality are imagined triumphant? Do such artists exist? Maybe Bonnard would be a candidate. But what do we disapprove of most deeply? Evasion and daydreaming, or beauty entwined with danger and monstrosity? This, as I say, is my preface. Let me now try to situate the two nudes in relation to the argument of the book they set in motion. Picasso and Truth centers on the question of what happened to Picasso's art as he found Cubism, the first heroic and comprehensive style of the 20th century, a style that had so largely been his own creation, fall apart somehow in his hands. The book centers on Picasso's painting in the 1920s. This is the central masterpiece of those years, The Three Dancers of 1925. The topic is worth exploring, I think, for several reasons. If you believe, as so many artists and critics have done, that the cubism Picasso and others invented before 1914 was as close as the past 100 years ever came to a usable common language for the modern condition, as close as we came to a period style, then the process by which that style became unusable by the man who'd made it, or unusable except in self-consuming quotation marks, may point to something about the modern condition itself. Picasso seems to have said as much. Here he is, as recalled in François Gillot's tremendous memoir, diagnosing why Cubism fell apart. I quote, "As soon as we saw that the collective adventure was a lost cause, each one of us had to find an individual adventure. And the individual adventure always goes back to the one which is the archetype of our modern times, that is Van Gogh's, an essentially solitary and tragic adventure." The three dances are certainly, in my view, tragic, but perhaps they're not yet as solitary and isolated as Van Gogh in his room in the asylum. Things can get worse. This wonderful and agonized picture of a human individual was done by Picasso in 1940, when he lived, as Lydia Gassman has told us, in constant fear of death from a new bombing campaign. I feel that this vision of the nude in the 20th century ought to be a constant companion in the back of our minds as we look at the nudes from 1942. Let me go back to the remark made to Gillot. The individual adventure in art always goes back to the one which is the archetype of our times, that is Van Gogh's, an essentially solitary and tragic one. Of course, risking a comparison between one's own project as an artist and that of Van Gogh has its dangers. The tragic and the solitary in the 20th century, produced by artists as explicitly the condition their art will address, those have often been trademarks of or alibis for truly terrible visual work. And when the tragic and solitary have been combined with the erotic, the terribleness, the ringingly false terribilità is usually just ratcheted up a notch. We shall all have our favorite candidates, I guess, for the worst sub-sad showman of the last 100 years. But isn't Picasso just such a showman time and again? Here's his repos, rest, right, of 1932. And here, extraordinarily, is him choosing to be photographed next to this vision of horror. Some critics, among them the best critics of Picasso, have thought as much. Picasso, after 1926 or so, wrote Clement Greenberg, became obsessed by a nostalgia for the monstrous, the epically brutal, and the blasphemous. And because this could only be nostalgia, in Greenberg's view, for scales and qualities no longer available to the artist except in the form of pastiche, in practice, his painting, says Greenberg, came to have, I quote, "something too literary about it, too many gestures, and too much forcing of color, texture, and symbol." Well, let's leave blasphemy aside. It's the other three qualities Greenberg points to: the monstrous, the brutal, or at least the unredeemably carnal, and the attempt at epic diction, grand simplifications and heroic intensification of means, These do seem essential to Picasso's way of painting once Cubism failed him. Or rather, it's these qualities compounded by or discovered in an endless erotic theater. And I suppose my book is, a little reluctantly, an attempt to explain why, though Greenberg's case against the generality of art like this is one I often agree with, I think Picasso very often got away with it. So I begin the book with two paintings that clearly were meant as masterpieces of the new manner. Nude on a black sofa, and Nude, Green Leaves, and Bust. The London picture on the left, and of course the picture around the corner now on the right. And I quote in the book a piece of writing about them that appears to disagree with Greenberg's skepticism more or less point by point. The piece of writing, this is the interesting part, comes from someone as deeply committed to the cause of Cubism as Greenberg ever was, the dealer and critic Daniel Henri Kahnweiler, who'd been Picasso and Braque's crucial supporter in the years before 1914. This is the letter he wrote to Michel Leiris in March 1932. I can't resist quoting it to you again. Yes, as you say, painting is only being kept alive by Picasso. But how marvelously! 2 days ago at his place, we saw two paintings he'd just done. Two nudes that are perhaps the greatest, most moving thing Picasso has ever produced. It seems as though a satyr who just killed a woman could have painted this picture, I said to him about one of the two. It's not cubist, not naturalistic. It's without any painterly artifice. It's very alive, very erotic, but with the eroticism of a giant. Picasso has done nothing comparable for many years. I'd love to paint like a blind man, he'd said a few days before, who pictures an ass by the way it feels. That's it, exactly. We came away from there stunned. Stunned is écrasé. Well, I realize again, sounding the disapproval note, that aspects of the studio chatter here are a bit lip-smacking and obnoxious. But the tone, here's the point, is wholly out of character for this particular writer. And the verdict he produces, the judgment that the new paintings are perhaps the greatest, most moving thing that Picasso had ever done, this judgment is the opposite of routine. Coming from Kahnweiler, this is very close to an admission of defeat. That to explain exactly why would take too long, but you know, this is not the kind of modern painting that Kahnweiler wanted, but he's somehow or other overwhelmed by it when it happens. Eroticism plus monstrosity, it seems, are painting's last hope. And there's something profoundly touching, I feel, for all the art world heavy breathing, in the spectacle of the crisp Prussian losing hold of his cubist dream of reconstruction and falling under the spell of Picasso's satyr dance. Down he goes into the world of giants. What I want to think about then in the rest of this talk is the nature of Picasso's eroticism. And the painting I'm going to concentrate on is Nude, Green Leaves, and Bust. As I said previously, I didn't know the painting well when I wrote Picasso and Truth. It only very recently emerged. This is it under the Christie's auction lights from a long cloistered life in Los Angeles. And it was its companion, Nude on a Black Sofa, that I talked about in the book's opening pages. The two paintings, Kahnweiler was surely right, are best thought of as a pair. I'll leave aside for a moment the question of which came first, but you can all have a guess or have your own intuition of which came first, and then I'll reveal later. Obviously, I don't intend to repeat here what I had to say in the book about Nude on a Black Sofa, but for my approach to its partner to make sense, I have to establish two things about it. First, the painting's enactment of sex and the body seems to me to turn on the question of the nude's proximity to us as viewers, the body's closeness, its existence as a thing one can imagine touching or even entering, its tactility, to use an old term of art. The painting on one level stakes everything on what seems at first sight an unmediated, overwhelming closeness. The nude is pressed forward to the picture plane. It takes up almost half the painted rectangle. The right-hand edge of the painting, you'll notice, can't contain it. But this nearness and availability are only the first impression. Many things in the painting contradict or counteract them. The picture's weird color preeminently, but also its drawing and its treatment of the space of the room. Nearness may be one moment of the body in this space of sexual desire, but deep remoteness seems to be another. Here's how my book sums things up. Kahnweiler is obviously right when he calls the painting very alive, very erotic, but right also when he immediately qualifies that evaluation with the phrase, but with the eroticism of a giant. That is, this is a kind of eroticism that seemingly doesn't quite belong to the world we non-giants belong to. The remark he reports Picasso making a few days earlier about the blind man and touch, I'd love to paint like a blind man who pictures an ass by the way it feels, is characteristic Picasso, not least in its lack of originality, but strikes me as leading viewers in the wrong direction. Touch, the imagination of a body's contact and softness and curvature, is consumed in Nude on a Black Sofa by something else, a higher, shallower, in the end more abstract visuality that never will be anyone's property. The nude's near hand, holding on to the claw-like white flower, is an emblem of this. Fingers and petals become pure predatory silhouette. The body's pale mauve, extraordinary color, which, you know, you can't reproduce, but you can see it for real. The body's pale mauve is as otherworldly a color, as unlocatable on the spectrum of flesh tone as the yellow and orange in the sky. Maybe in the picture, night is falling. The blue wall to the left is icy cold. The woman's blonde hair is sucked violently into a vortex next to her breast. Blacks encase her as if for eternity. The rubber plant tries to escape through the window. Which is to say, I'm adopting Kahnweiler's strategy, of course, and casting about for metaphors appropriate to a metaphorical triumph, that the picture's whole point seems to be that the nude in Nude on a Black Sofa is both there and not there in the space provided, and that the same goes a fortiori for who or whatever brought her into being. Is the black and mauve body close to the artist and to us looking on from the artist's place? Or has the painting put the body somehow far away? Is it touchable or untouchable? Exultant or comatose? Compliant or self-enclosed. Well, I'd like to emphasize two aspects of the description just quoted, since they're really the two main themes of the book. First, that the reality of things, the truth of things, their imaginable humanity, their humanness, for Picasso seems bound up above all with the question of their nearness and the possibility of their being manipulable, touchable, a mixture of soft and solid. All the same, Picasso says to Roland Penrose, it's a funny thing, flesh, to be built of flesh. Imagine a house built of flesh. It wouldn't last long. That's a lovely Picasso quote. Flesh is Picasso's subject, and the way to it is proximity. It follows then that the extent to which, here, nearness and distance are interchangeable, or as we used to say, undecidable, does represent for Picasso a real crisis in his view of the world and how to represent it. His key terms of difference are in free flow. Nearness and distance, and therefore tactility and abstraction. And this is bound up with what has happened in the Wexner's Nude, what Picasso has made happen to his other key term, the room. For Picasso, being is essentially being in. This is the great still life from 24 in the Guggenheim. An object is only fully a human possession, and therefore for Picasso interesting, by dint of belonging to room space. And by those last two words, I mean nothing very technical, simply that the reality Picasso is capable of imagining is contained usually in four walls, or some synecdoche implying the four walls, plus a tilted floor and a tabletop, with behind them a further back wall, maybe pierced by a window, as it is here, but only the better to establish the familiarity, the inclusiveness, the availability of the instruments and part objects up front. So again, the question occurs, is there room space in Nude on a black sofa? Are its ice blue wall and the hellfire window tokens of room space, are its ice blue wall and the hellfire window tokens of room space or travesties of room space? Do they end up annihilating anything in the picture that might, in the way that a room should, hold and enclose and protect? The psychoanalytic overtones of those last verbs seem apt. Hold, enclose, protect. For what is eroticism to be? What is caring for and reaching out towards another being going to be like if it has no interior to take place in? Maybe the issues will become clearer if we now turn to Nude, Green Leaves and Bust. But for a moment, here are the two paintings again side by side. I think, as I've been saying, that Nude on a Black Sofa is about the paradoxical nature of immediacy in painting, about the way proximity and availability and openness to possession become, in practice after Cubism, something else, something colder, more abstract, more deeply perplexing. About what happens to these dimensions of experience in Nude, Green Leaves and Bust, I'm even less sure. The painting seems to me almost now to begin from the idea of distance and unreality, or at least to have that idea shape the whole picture space. The idea, I mean, that eroticism is always a kind of theater, with the naked body framed and confined by a flimsy apparatus of curtains, cushions, strange bands or bonds of black. Notice, for instance, that the cold blue curtain in the painting, is it colored an icy blue itself, or could it be transparent to the sky, is pinned to or hung from a set of four yellow buttons. It's as if the scene takes place inside some kind of improvised alcove or tent. The canvas starts off from this atmosphere of elaboration and constructedness. This is the immediate contrast, isn't it, between it and Nude on a black sofa. But where it gets to, what in the end it proposes about desire and identification and doubling, strikes me as truly hard to get a handle on. What we are shown here, to state the obvious, is a darker world than that of Nude on a black sofa. For all the blackness of the black sofa, right, the overall atmosphere of Nude on a black sofa is more electric and less muted. Darker and maybe a little more secure. Picasso is an artist, I've been saying, whose whole vision of life is premised on closeness and containment. So the reappearance of those possibilities in Nude, Green Leaves and Bust is intensely charged. This picture's world is still hankering after and half pretending to actually provide the safety and enclosure of a room. Maybe even the erotic warmth, the shared secrecy behind the curtain. But the offer immediately doubles back on itself. The room space here is transparently an illusion, built, jerry-rigged out of drapes pinned up inside some further unreadable space. And transparently, I've suggested, is a metaphor that's materialized in the painting, as metaphors always are in Picasso if he's really possessed by them. The extraordinary blue here, well, really, there are three blues getting darker from left to right. Isn't quite liquid, but not quite airy, and not at all blue velvety and soft. It's the opposite, for instance, of the extraordinary invading forward rush of the blue in Three Dancers. One of the things I have to say about the blue in Three Dancers in my book, and I see the blue and its forward pressure as a key instance of what I want to call the arrival of untruth into Picasso's world, is that it has been given a face. The blue in the upper half of the left-hand window here has been outlined, you'll notice, in red along its right profile. And it's easy to read the profile as crudely human, a blue face peering into the room. You'll notice that notoriously there is an answering black profile, a bit blubber-lipped and foolish-looking, in the window on the right-hand side. That's, of course, far clearer, indisputable. Some viewers don't see the blue face in the window at left. I'm not going to insist on it. But certainly I feel that Picasso has given the blue a face in Nude, Green Leaves and Bust. Yeah, I guess now let me see whether I can do it. Is this a pointer? Does it point or not? Well, okay, maybe you can see it, right? A big nose, it's a sort of profile face facing left. Do you see it, or am I? Yeah, okay. A profile blue face with the nose sort of following the track of the green leaves, the stem of green leaves. Yeah. Okay. It's certainly, I think he's given the blue a face in the picture. And it has a little of the blubber-lipped blandness of its three dancers' black twin, okay? See the famous dark face? It's almost as if this blue face is sort of repeating that profile or blowing it up. The face is there, right at the center of the curtain, like a set of billowing folds in the material, between the weird green leaves and the weirder gray halo or aura surrounding the sculpture on its plinth. I wonder if members of the audience, once I pointed it out, immediately without thinking, gave the face, once they'd spotted it, a gender. I can't get back to my first apperception, but I believe my present and continuing one, that the profile flickers between male and female, is fully motivated by the whole picture itself. The face might seem to be an emanation, an extrapolation, a floating out into three dimensions of the peculiar wafer-thin bust on the black marble plinth. And that bust, I suppose we'd intuit this even if we didn't know of the actual sculptures Picasso was engaged on in 1931 and 32. Here's a couple of them. That face, that profile, is female. It is his model, Marie-Thérèse. The sculpted Marie-Thérèse looks down on the painted Marie-Thérèse. Or maybe if we'd have simply the painting of the sculpture, we'd think the face of the woman in the sculpture did not look down, that she was fixing her cold classical eye on the leaves and drapery straight across from her in the picture, not looking down towards the exultant body below. But then, the blue extrapolation comes to help us. The blue face does seem to be looking downwards, doesn't it? Gently? Tenderly? Is this what we think? Or is there something implacable and distant to the profile, derived from the color of its darkening blue? Is the blue face female? Is it some mediating state of Marie-Thérèse herself? It's deeply linked to her. The double S-curve of the blue face's lips and nose is closer to the double S-curve of the sleeping woman on the cushions than to the bifurcated profile, nose and forehead stopping the flow of line below of the plaster head. But then the memory comes back of the profiles of onlookers that appear in Picasso paintings done a year or two earlier. Here's two of them. You see on the left, the profiles in the dark one on the right, and on the left-hand painting, it's in white on the left, looking through the window, through the window, I guess. Often in these silhouettes do seem to be male, don't they? Weakly, schematically male, but male all the same, or even more so. Often in the Picasso literature, it's taken for granted, maybe too eagerly, that in these earlier paintings, the profiles are Picasso himself. I don't think finally that the blue profile in Nude, Green Leaves and Bust is any more indubitably Picasso than it is Marie-Thérèse. It's both. It's neither. It's the face of in-betweenness. Of course, this being Picasso, that in-betweenness of the blue face is very much more than a matter of shared or distributed features. It's a matter of placement, of the figure's location in space, or its making of space. Compare the blue face in Three Dances again. I'd say that this blue face, the one in Three Dances, is the face of the outside world looking in, its red edge flipping it forward across the windowsill. It is the face of facing front, facing things, face-to-faceness. It slices imperatively into the space of the room. But in 1932, the face looming out from the bust on the table, gloomily, maybe lazily, maybe a kind of sad emanation from the statue, seems to me the face of a deeper, still weirder kind of nowhereness. It's neither outside nor in, neither here with us, as Picasso so constantly wanted things to be, nor out there in some impalpable distance. "I believe in phantoms," he said once to Kahnweiler. "They're not misty vapors. They're something hard. When you want to stick a finger in them, they react." I don't believe this phantom is within reach of anybody's fingers. And fingers themselves, again, this is a charged decision for Picasso, who's a great painter of hands and digits. Fingers are reduced in Nude, Green Leaves, and Bust to a dazzling, impalpable double S-curve of pure line. You see the fingers complete with dislocated phallic thumb underneath the Nude's thrown back head. It's characteristic of Picasso's painting in the later 1920s and early 30s that often Matisse seems to be on his mind. I think he is here. The pinned-up curtains and the atmosphere of elaborate sexual artifice, sort of theater, in Nude with Green Leaves, in contrast to the self-canceling starkness of the Wexner's picture, seem like a direct, maybe half-ironic homage to the outlandish interior constructions, part Morocco, part Art Deco, that Matisse built in Nice in the 1920s for his Jazz Age odalisques. This odalisque, O Magnolia, from 1923 would be a fair comparison, or the odalisque in Grey Trousers of 1927. Of course, the atmosphere in Picasso is different, wilder, stranger, more secretive, surely more ominous. But be careful. It isn't the case that these latter qualities were always absent from the paintings Matisse did in his Nice apartment. This is the Matisse paradox, that the absurd homemade Côte d'Azur Casbah he made for himself did repeatedly open onto the truly unexpected. I would say that most deeply, Picasso's Nude with Green Leaves and Bust is an answer to the most extraordinary of Matisse's interwar paintings, the figure décorative sur fond ornemental from the winter of 1926. This picture has always presented difficulties to Matisse's admirers. Alfred Barr, in his great monograph, called it, in a phrase I love, a triumph of art over factitious vulgarity. And then he added, "Yet because the picture is so clearly an act of will in a field of artifice, the victory does seem pyrrhic." "But exactly," I imagine Picasso replying, "it is because the picture so fully admits, makes manifest the fact that eroticism is an act of will in a field of artifice, that this is the painting of Matisse's that I most love and most have to reckon with." "The best I can do," says Picasso, "is replace vulgarity by transparency and sensual overload by blue gloom. The cranky, absurd leaves in the Picasso are alas left over from Matisse's stifling boudoir. We might say this more generally. The unapologetic unreality of Matisse's interior setups in the 1920s doesn't at all carry, I think, a tragic cast. Sex and art are unreal for Matisse and accepted as such. He's made a life inside their twin illusions. Je fais des odalisques pour faire du nu, he says to Thériade. Mais comment faire du nu sans qu'il soit factice? I do odalisques in order to do the nude. But how does one do a nude without it being factitious? I mean, factitious meaning got up, artificial, unnatural. It's a wonderful phrase, I think. How do you do a nude without it being factitious? That's what art's like. That's what life is like. Matisse doesn't mind if the elaborateness of his setups seems willful or fussy or even a bit fatuous. If you know of a better world, go to it. That seems to me his painting's message. And of course, Picasso agrees. He agrees basically with Matisse's conclusion. He's every bit as dismissive in the 1932 painting of all the surrounding instructions in the very same year in Paris, terrible year in Paris, that art in this dreadful moment should engage with modern life or the world of the unconscious or even ally itself to the Association des Écrivains et Artistes Révolutionnaires. The latter was founded in 1932 with several of Picasso's key acquaintances involved. It is in general this moment one of the high times of revolutionary surrealism. Picasso was the surrealist's idol and totem, but even they realize that what he did existed at a tangent to their politics. Picasso is with Matisse in his late 19th century high individualism, but the tone of his solitude is different. The cave of eroticism in Picasso's work, the pinned-up tent city of art and abandon, is a place of confinement, not just containment. The black bars of shadow dividing the nude's body in the Picasso only make that explicit. We might say, half adopting the language of British psychoanalysis again, that never has a naked body been divided into parts that are less part objects. That is to say, less the self-sufficient, completely fixated, seemingly natural and necessary little totalities made by desire. This is a body divided with dreadful artifice. The black bands, to dwell on them for a moment, are truly an overdetermined, uninterpretable device. They make me think of Blake's Infant Sorrow. Bound and weary, I thought best to sulk upon my mother's breast. And I believe, incidentally, that the bands too emerge from Picasso's continual thinking with and against Matisse. A strong black in a painting that leaks out of its initial home in the composition and moves across the body next to it is a constant structuring principle of Matisse's work from 1914 on. The painter and model from 1916 would be a good ordinary example of this flowing, leaking, binding black. Or, showing the action of the black localized, as it were, and happening dramatically in one specific place, here's the wonderful portrait of Pellerin, done the same year. Or, more pervasively, in Goldfish and Palette, the strange masterpiece again from 1916. I'm sure, by the way, that this painting was fundamental for Picasso. I think that the picture's unplaceable blacks live on in Nude, Green Leaves and Bust, and also, come to that, its blues. And really, its whole weird reimagining of room and window. I don't think, to come back to the black paint specifically, that Picasso knew why he found Matisse's blacks so transfixing. And I certainly don't think he knew what he was doing when he turned them into the harder, narrower, flimsier black bands of the painting from 1932. Maybe the best we can do, trying to get the measure of the bands, is to see them as representations, enactments of what representation is in the act of sex, the moment of bounding, dividing, interrupting, which is always the other face of touching, fusing, possessing, the moment at which, maybe necessarily, body becomes image, and convexity and concavity become abstract shape, form in the eye. Let me shift focus. The two nudes we are looking at are dated March the 8th and 9th, 1932. This is the moment to tell you that Nude, Green Leaves and Bust was the first of the two to be painted. It's kind of interesting, I think, actually. You know, I'm not sure that I've ever have... but I think it's sort of quite typical, actually, of Picasso, that he sort of moves from a more elaborate, confined setup towards something with the shock of immediacy, and yet the immediacy is then so puzzling. There's a wonderful final dreamscape version of the nude done a few days later on March the 13th. Fabulous, deliberately unfinished painting. But then, a month further on April the 14th, there's this, Nude in a Room. And 4 days previously, on April the 10th, Woman with a Flower. Or, moving back from the second week of March 1932, the time of the two nudes, to January the same year, January 32, just a few months before, there's this, Woman in a Red Armchair, January the 27th. And 5 days earlier, this, Repos, le repos. Never has repose been less reposeful. Now we have more of an idea what kind of choice Picasso made among the works of the winter and spring when he had himself photographed, as I showed you before, in front of the shrieking phantasmagoria. And equally, it should give us pause that 2 days after finishing repose, he painted a dream as pendant to the previous nightmare. Let me put repos finally alongside Nude on a Black Sofa. What I want now to fully admit and try to make sense of is the thin line in Picasso's work after Cubism between proximity and outright otherness, which in turn may mean, though not necessarily, between desirability and horror. Readers of Picasso and Truth will know that for me, one main, though enigmatic, clue to these matters comes in a conversation the artist had with his friend Geneviève Laporte. She says it happened around 1950. Picasso had been showing her a kind of journal he kept, containing a lock of his one-time lover Doramar's hair. I'm going to turn aside for a moment and establish who Dora Maar was and why what Picasso had to say about her may be so important to understanding him. Of course, this is appropriate because, again, the show around the corner contains a wonderful sequence of Dora Maar pictures. The great 1940 woman doing her hair is a picture of Dora. She was a left-wing surrealist, a very fine photographer, and Picasso's companion and lover all through the late 1930s and on into the war years. She was in that period the subject of extraordinarily tender drawings. This one is from the year of Guernica, 1937. I mean, you know, it's one of these Picasso moments where he says, well, I mean, you know, I'll show you. And of course, the subject of many, many paintings. Most of them, of course, much less epic and doom-laden than Woman Doing Her Hair. Here, for instance, is a portrait of her, again, from 1937. Lovely thing. And finally, before I turn back to the 1950 conversation, I should show you a photo that I think conjures up the retrospective, maybe even nostalgic, nature of Picasso's words to Laporte. Though you'll soon see that Picasso's nostalgia is not much like anyone else's. He leafs through, it's a lovely, touching picture, this, isn't it? Of the, you know, he's already, of course, an old man at this stage, but sort of reviewing these great portraits. So he leafs through the journal with the lock of Dora's hair, and then abruptly he tries to explain. I wasn't in love with Dora Maar. I loved her as a man, and I told her repeatedly, you don't please me, I don't love you. I'm going to give you the French because it's so extraordinary. Je n'aimais pas Dora Maar. Je l'aimais comme un homme. Et je lui répétais, tu ne me plais pas. Je ne t'aime pas. I mean, kind of. Well, their relationship was like that, okay? Frank. And then this remark provokes an extraordinary generalization. I think we need to listen to it with these images back on screen. Je suis une femme, he says. Tout artiste est une femme et doit être guine. Les pédérastes artistes ne peuvent pas être de vrais artistes car ils aiment des hommes. Comme ils sont des femmes, ils retombent dans le normal. Well, heaven knows how you translate this, right? But I'll have a go. Any artist is a woman and has to be a lesbian. I mean, it's actually lesbian is far too polite, right? You know. Any artist is a woman and has to be lesbian. Artists who are pederasts can't be real artists because they love men. And as they are women, they fall back into normalcy. That's what the sentence is saying. Well, these are perplexing sentences. Set aside for a moment, if you can, the ludicrous and, you know, repellent condescension towards the pederast, and let's try to take seriously the glimpse we get here, uniquely, I think, of Picasso's conception of the structure of desire in representation. We're dealing, remember, with an artist who is insistently and often disturbingly a painter of women, seemingly from a man's point of view. He is infamously the painter of desire. And here he is, talking to a very close woman friend, Genevieve Laporte. At this point, by the way, 1950, one of his key communist comrades, about the basic facts, as he sees them, of art and sexual difference, right? They're absolutely central to what is his view of life and art. Any artist is a woman, I repeat the strange half-argument, and must be a dyke. Artists who are pederasts can't be real artists because they love men. As they are women, they fall back into normalcy. Well, listen, I'm not going to claim at this point to make sense of these sentences. It may be that what matters most about them is that they don't make sense. That you can see Picasso carried off on a wave of peculiar displacements and doublings back, so that in the space of 30 words, the listener inevitably loses track of who's who, and who in particular here is Picasso. I asked a gay art historian friend, and I, a great friend, Jeremy Melius, a few months ago, whether I was just being a bit sort of casual and insensitive, asking an audience to put aside, at least provisionally, the sentence's noxious attitude to homosexuality. And he replied, well, for myself, I find it impossible to feel offended by them, or even addressed by them. Picasso is so clearly losing his way in the forest of sexual difference and sexual identification. That's what's so extraordinary. Where is he? What's his sexuality by the end of the first four weird statements? I agree with this completely, but I still want to have a go at excavating what seems to me the underlying argument. Representation in general, Picasso says here and repeatedly, is driven in human beings by desire. It is desire's derivative, and therefore dependent on sexual difference. But the ultimate driving force of art, he seems to be telling Laporte, is its moment of identification with the different. The artist's desire for a woman as a woman would enact, would feel the desiring. A work of art aims to show us desire for the same, in other words, desire for what a woman is as it might be felt by the woman. But always in the knowledge that this identification in representation for a male artist is a great as if, a breaking of taboo. I mean, you shouldn't be there, right, in the place of the woman. A man should not occupy the desiring woman's place. The danger and marvel of eroticism is that he can, he dares to. Here lies the problem of the homosexual painter, so Picasso imagines. Of course, a homosexual is drawn to depicting men, this seems to be the logic, but from a position of woman that he occupies naturally, continuously, in the everyday life of desire. Therefore, the act of representation doesn't disrupt the normal circuit of his fantasy of identification and difference. It confirms it. And this, Picasso thinks, is bad news for art. It means that the otherness, the particularity, the unknownness of the object of desire is not jolted into the foreground of perception in the act of painting itself. It means that the love object doesn't appear otherwise in representation, as seen from somewhere, some other subject position that only representation makes possible, and then fleetingly, dangerously. Let me go back to the strange blue profile in the Nude from 1932 and repeat those last few words. Seen from somewhere, some other subject position that only representation makes possible, and then fleetingly dangerously. I think the flickering into half-being of the blue looker's profile in 1932 comes close to figuring, almost thematizing, this scene from somewhere else. It's the figure of the in-betweenness that painting, Picasso thinks, exists to make possible. Maybe even the worn out words tragic and solitary could apply here. And as for the dangerousness of the result, well, don't think simply of the moments in Picasso's work of explicit apotropaic looking back. The moment of dematerialization, of deep withdrawal into a distance that representation can only guess at, is ultimately just as wonderful and unnerving. I think, to sum up, I'm right at the end now, that Picasso's words, strange and, you know, disagreeable as they are, help us with the two nudes of 1932. The pictures are a first and second try, it seems to me, at imagining the other that comes into being in the space of sex, the desired and desiring body, holding and sheltering itself, embracing its sexuality, and therefore addressing itself to itself and another, without self-loss or abjection or mere ruthless projection of its wishes. And I go further and say that in many a work by Picasso, even the I am a woman, je suis une femme, is realized. Remember that the foiled immediacy of nude on a black sofa, the closeness that becomes remoteness as we look, comes after the elaborate compartmentalized sexual enclosure of nude, green leaves and bust. The Matisse interior is imitated, celebrated, and then annihilated. In the painting done second, the Wexner's painting, the nude is nowhere in particular. This puts everyone at risk. The annihilation of room space is as much a threat to the woman's sleeping self-enclosure as it is to our reaching out imaginatively to possess her. Desiring her as she might desire herself, being suddenly in a space or a circuit of desiring where here and there, he and she, subject and object, are consumed by sheer chilling purple presence. This is astonishing, and in a certain way, every time you see the painting, hard to bear. Wonderful, but unnerving. The world is hostile, Picasso said once to Malraux. Sex and hostility will never be entirely disentangled, alas. The armchair is death. Again, a saying of Picasso's which crops up in Malraux's memoir, which in this case doesn't seem far-fetched, right? He says to Malraux, the armchair is death. The leaves are absurd, flaccid penises. Of course, the remark to Laporte that every artist is a woman, every artist is a woman, could be read as just another male appropriation of the female for the same old purposes. There is some truth to this, but in the end, it seems to me too defensive a reaction. I think the viewer is truly being invited, maybe even maneuvered, in nude on a black sofa, into a place where the normal to and fro and passive and active of gender do not quite operate. The body possesses us, us just as much as the person it belongs to. Hair and flower float free of their normal connotations. Nobody's fingers will ever quite get hold of them. Desire is not ours any longer. And that does amount, I think, to a glimpse of a better life. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we do have time for some questions. I've gone on a bit long, as usual. But we do have time for questions, and I'm very glad to take them. Please, yes.
Yeah, thank you for that. The question I have for you, given that Picasso said that the black sofa is death, and that, how do you know this woman is sleeping and not dead, given her blue violaceous coloring?
Well, you don't know, of course, right? I mean, you know, that's the wonderful thing about painting, is that it will never usually, or I think good painting actually does sort of put you thinking exactly, thinking about things like that. What's the edge between sleep and death, right? You know, an old theme of art and reflection. I guess I'd say, well, if this is death, then it's the most animate, the most animate death I've ever seen represented in art, right? I mean, you know, this body is encased by the black, but it's a body which is, you know, just bursting with life. But it's a good question. I mean, death is there. Death is there. But, and of course, that leads back to the period sense of eroticism, which, by the way, I find, you know, dangerous. But I find the period view of, right, the Freudian, between the wars, 20th century view of the erotic and the kind of dangerous connection of desire with aggression and the death wish. I find that still, you know, uncomfortably to be reckoned with. We've sort of purged it from the sayable in our culture. But it's absolutely fundamental to Picasso's view. Sex and death, right next door.
Hello. I'm just curious what you might do with an observation that I keep coming back to in this particular painting, which is that the hand and the flower, which you sort of described as a claw. And you can certainly see that little, you know, arcing line that is a bit sharp there. But for me, that seems to speak more, it looks to me more like a handkerchief. Like there is, like the skin of the body is really sort of revealed as two-dimensional.
Yes.
And, you know, when you put it next to the other painting and the curtains, it seemed to me that was doing something like this hand, this handkerchief, as I want to call it, is doing something kind of similar.
Yes.
And it turns the body into this kind of distended balloon, like something swollen. Yes. And this is the part of it that's just sort of hanging loose there or tied up. So do with that what you want.
I think it's wonderful. And yes, it's sort of, I agree with you that the hand and the flower, they're always also like a kind of glove, right? You don't know where flesh ends and material begins. And suddenly, as you were talking, it triggered some great lines from Yeats that I always remember, which are sort of central to his view of the erotic. I did the dragon's will until you came, because I thought love a casual improvisation or a game that followed when the kerchief fell. But eventually I grew up, and it's not a game that follows when the kerchief falls. It's you know, it's something more. But I don't know what to do with that, but it just, yeah.
put up the Tate one?
Yes.
So this is just a minor observation, and I think it...
I'll go back to the whole thing of the Tate, shall I?
Sure, whatever. It's just a comment about what you refer to as the bands.
Yes.
And they're intriguing and enigmatic. The only, I guess, qualification I would want to make is, to me, they read very separately. So that there's the black one on the left.
Yes.
That.
How can it be that it's so far back, the whole thing? Right, is that it?
I'll take a partial view.
Okay,
there we go.
That'll do fine. Yeah.
The one on the left is very two-dimensional in my reading, very black. The one on the right is gray and curved and more plausibly reads as shadow because it's a variable thickness. And again, I think it's a minor point that largely substantiates what you want to read in the Wexner painting, but the gray one on the right suggests the curvature of her body, insinuates to me the presence of that body, the solidity of the form, whereas the black one on the left immediately pushes her away. She becomes two-dimensional. She becomes mere representation or mere image. And so maybe part of that is what gets reworked in the Wexner painting.
Yes.
Ask the kind of neither here nor there that you want to see in that one.
Yes, I think that's wonderful. And of course, I've sort of not quite... hadn't quite seen till you were sort of pointing these things out that the real difference between the two. That's really, really helpful. And also the way in which the gray on the right is again another sort of emanation or flow out from the aura around the bust, whereas where the other black comes from, it's just And then that kind of leads to the idea, well, sometimes, of course, given all the gossip surrounding Picasso's sexuality, you sort of think, oh, is this bondage? Oh, God. Well, of course it's bondage, and, who knows, right? And who cares? But actually, I mean, there's a tremendous difference, isn't there, between the two bonds. The gray is, in some ways, following a possible curve of the body. The black is just a sort of abstract thing which comes from outside and crosses.
And stops short of the bottom edge, whereas the gray one continues.
So it does. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Very helpful.
I'm just being too obvious, but that black band I find very disturbing. It cuts her head off.
Yes.
She's not lavender, she's white. Talk about death.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm with you. I hope it is disturbing. And of course you can say that these things interrupt and dislocate and maybe, do violence to the body. I think that's part of it. That's part of it. But my goodness, the body fights back. It's right. It's both interrupted by these, but it's also staged and magnified, and the whole surrounding supports and dramatizes the bodies. I mean, never forget that on one level, these are celebrations of the absolute untouchability of this other's body, right? Sleep is her self-enclosure, right? Her being for herself. And the painting's trying to reach out and find ways of touching and being with that other body again. So it is a to and fro, and I absolutely agree with you that, it one moment of your looking is rightly shocked. I mean, it goes back right to the beginning where we're saying, I don't approve, but But are we in a space where approval is at all the word? Shall we have? Yes. And I suppose on that note, it is a good place to end. Thank you very much for your questions.